فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على من أرسله الله رحمة للعالمين، سيدنا ونبينا محمد آخر الأنبياء في الدنيا عصرا وأجلهم يوم القيامة شأنا وذكرا، صلى الله وملائكته والصالحون من خلقه كما وحد الله وعرف به ودعا إليه، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى we're in the explanation of the book كتاب الورقات written by الإمام أبي معالي الجويني رحمه الله. We previously spoke about أبواب أصول الفقه, the chapters in which أصول الفقه deals with. We also mentioned how they are all categorized and which heading that they all fall under. Inshallah ta'ala, today we're going to enter into the chapter or the fasl, the unit called Aqsamul Kalam, the types of speech there is. Without any further ado, inshallah ta'ala, we will enter the lesson bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. Sam.
Types of speech, kalam. At the very least, speech, kalam, must consist of two nouns, or a noun and a verb, or a verb and a particle, or a noun and a particle. Speech divided into command, prohibition, report, inquiry, as well as wish, offer, and oath. In another respect, it is divided into literal and metaphorical. Literal means it is used in the sense for which it was first coined, or it is said that it was used according to convention. Metaphorical means that it is taken beyond the sense for which it was first coined. Literal use can be linguistic, lughawi, juridical, shari'i, or customary, urfi. Metaphorical use can be by addition, subtraction, transference, or borrowing of meaning. Metaphorical use by addition is like Allah saying, English meaning, there is nothing like His likeness. Figurative use by subtraction is like Allah saying, ask the town. Metaphorical use by transference is like hollow, being used for what comes out of a person. Metaphorical use by borrowing is like Allah saying, a wall that wants to collapse.
فصل. أما أقسام الكلام فأقل ما يتركب منه الكلام اسمان أو اسم وفعل. والكلام ينقسم إلى أمر ونهي وخبر واستخبار، ومن وجه آخر ينقسم إلى حقيقة ومجاز. فالحقيقة ما بقي على موضوعه، وقيل ما استعمل في ما اصطلح عليه من المخاطبة. والمجاز ما تجوز به عن موضوعه. والحقيقة إما أن تكون لغوية أو شرعية أو عرفية، والمجاز إما أن يكون بزيادة أو نقصان أو نقل أو استعارة. فالمجاز بالزيادة مثل قوله تعالى ليس كمثله شيء، والمجاز بالنقصان مثل قوله تعالى واسأل القرية، والمجاز بالنقل كالغائط فيما يخرج من الإنسان، والمجاز بالاستعارة كقوله تعالى جدار يريد أن ينقض.
The author رحمه الله, الإمام أبي معالي الجويني رحمه الله, he mentions here the types of speech, أقسام الكلام. The reason why he chose to make a chapter like this is because لأن خطاب الشرع مرده إلى الكلام, because the addressing and the addressing of the Sharia, it goes back to speech, right? Because فإن الله أوحى إلى رسوله, Allah sent revelation on our Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, right? And how did the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم convey what Allah sent onto him? How did he transmit it to us? He did it one of two ways. The first one is وَمِنْهُ مَا هُوَ مِنْ كَلَامِ اللَّهِ وَهُوَ الْقُرْآنُ وَالْحَدِيثُ الْقُدْسِي. The first one is Allah's speech, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is known as the Qur'an, and it's also known as Hadith al-Qudsi. The second one is the speech, which is the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's speech. So let's rephrase that again. The author, rahimahullah, he started, or he mentions in this chapter, the types of speeches there is. And the reason why he chose to make a topic like this, which is al-kalamu, is because if you look at the sharia today, it goes back to kalam. Either it's a kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is Quran or Hadith al-Qudsi, or it's a speech of the Messenger alayhi salatu wa salam, or it's the speech of who? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's important for the person to have understanding and comprehension of the speech, because that is what the religion stands on. That is what the sharia, it transmits its information in that particular way. So the author, rahimahullah, if you look at how he categorized the speech, is in the following. He categorized it in three. The author, rahimahullah, he categorized the speech into three. The first one is تقسيم الكلام باعتبار ما يترتب منه. Looking at speech from the angle of how much it consists of. And what it means is that how much is it compounded of? In simple terms, what's the minimum a speech can be? That's the first one. And he mentions here, ismani two nouns. أو اسم وفعل. Or a noun and a verb. Or a noun and a verb. أو اسم وحرف. And he also mentions a noun and a particle. And you see the copies are different, so some copies may not mention it. أو فعل وحرف, or a verb and a particle. Now the last two are disputed amongst the grammarians. They don't accept that as the minimum of a speech. And we took this vigorously and in details. We took it in our explanation of Al-Mutammimatul Ajurumiyyah, in which we explained it. أَقَلُّ مَا يَتَأَلَّفُ مِنْهُ الْكَلَامُ. The minimum a speech is compounded of. Because they say, for example, Ya Allah. Is that not a kalam? Is it not a speech? Well, they say, then look at this. This is a harf and a noun. So we have a noun and a harf. But they are responded to. We're saying that no. The word Ya here means, أُنَادِ اللَّهَ, I am calling unto Allah. The Ya here is not the mutaallaq, it's not connected to it. So the sentence is not just a particle that you're looking at, which is the word ya, and the issue of Allah. But anyways, in more details, we don't want to enter that. We just want to, inshallah ta'ala, make these classes of al-waraqat simple, easy, and then inshallah ta'ala, we'll do it again, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, in more details, and tarjihat of the opinions that are out there. So the first type of categorization of speech is what? تقسيم الكلام باعتبار ما يترتب ما يترتب منه. Looking at the speech in terms of how it's compounded. The second one is تقسيم الكلام باعتبار مدلوله. It is looking at speech in terms of its meaning. أي معناه. Looking at speech in terms of its meaning. And this is where the author said, رحمه الله تعالى, والكلام ينقسم إلى أمر ونهي وخبر واستخبار وينقسم أيضا إلى تمن وعرض وقسم. And also that wasn't mentioned in the copy of أخونا سعد. Which is what? وينقسم أيضا إلى تمن وعرض وقسم. Some copies don't have that. But those three are not very important, which is the issue of تمن وعرض وقسم. And it really is not dealt in, especially, it's not really dealt with when it comes to kalam in the Quran and the Sunnah too much. There are not many mabahith written about it, because its need and its importance is not as important as the rest. The scholars, on the other hand, what they spend too much time on is two. And you could actually say that the second type of categorization that we were looking at, which is تقسيم الكلام باعتبار مدلوله أي معناه, looking at speech in terms of its meaning, are you with me, brothers? Which I just mentioned, which is ينقسم إلى أمر ونهي. And أمر and نهي, I'm not going to talk about it, because the author, right after this one, he makes a whole chapter for it. And نهي. It makes a whole chapter. These are the backbones, command and prohibitions. So he makes a whole chapter for it. which we're going to see inshallah ta'ala, so there's no need for us to go ahead of ourselves and explain it now. ونهين. But khabar واستخبار is also another. Are you with me, brothers? Khabar and istikhbar, which is what all of these types can be brought back to. Are you with me, brothers? Is two things it can be brought back to. It can be brought back to al-khabar, which is the first one. And the second one, which is al-insha'. Are you with me, brothers? The second type of categorization which I mentioned, which is al-kalam yanqasimu ila amrin wa nahyin wa khabarin wa istikhbarin wa yanqasimu ayda ila tamannin wa aradin wa qasamin. They can all be brought back to one of two. Are you with me, brothers? It goes back to only of these two. All of those, they go back to two, which is وَهَذِي الْأَنْوَاعَ الْمُتَعَدِّدَةِ يَرْجِعُ. It goes back to أَمَا تَرْجِعُ إِلَى النَّوْعَيْنِ اثْنَتَيْنِ. It goes back to these two. يَرْجِعُ. It goes back to إِلَى النَّوْعَيْنِ اثْنَيْنِ. It goes back to these two, which is الْخَبَرُ. And I'll explain what it means, don't worry. And the second one is الْإِنْشَاءَ. Are you with me, brothers? So if you look at the kalam in terms of its meaning, if somebody asks you today, simple question, the Qur'an, when we look at its speech in terms of meaning, what does it go back to? It's only two. Either it's a khabar or it's an insha. وَمَا تَعْرِفُهُمَا. What are the definitions for both of them? Al-khabaru, my brothers, is well known by what the scholars they say. Pay attention to this, brothers. Khabar is what? مَا يَقْبَلُ الصِّدْقَ أَوِ الْكَذِيبَ لِذَاتِهِ. It is anything that accepts being right. So the first one is khabar. Huh? The first one is al-khabaru. And it is ma yaqbalu as-sidqa. It accepts being right, being truth. Awil kadiba, or it can be a lie. It's anything which you can say to a person, you are telling the truth, you are lying. If anybody says something to you and you can say to them, you are lying. Are you with me, brothers? If somebody says to you today, if somebody says to you, brother, stand up, can you say you're lying? No, you can't. Is that a khabar now? That's not a khabar. Khabar is what? If I say to you, brother, I just drove when I came here. You say, no, you didn't. Oh, yeah, oh, yeah, you did. You're right, you did. Yeah, it's true, you did. Your car's outside. Whatever I said right now, what does it accept? يَقْبَلُ الصِّدْقَ أَوِ الْكَذِيبَ لِذَاتِهِ. Why do the usuliyin mention the word لِذَاتِهِ? I'm going to come to it, inshallah ta'ala. لِذَاتِهِ means in and within itself. So this is an ihtiraz. They're trying to get away from something. And this is the definitions, this is what they should have. A definition should be compounded of two things according to the mantiqiyin, which is that it has to be comprehensive, which is jami', and it also has to be mani'. It has to prevent other things from entering into the definition. And that's where the concept of ihtiraz comes into. When you define something, you're meant to automatically get rid of other things that shouldn't enter into the definition. So we will look into what the word لِذَاتِهِ means. The second one is al-insha'u. Insha' is the opposite to al-khabar. It is مَا لَا يَقْبَلُ الصِّدْقَ أَوِ الْكَذِبَ لِذَاتِهِ. It is anything that you basically can't say you're lying or you're telling the truth. And that's why Al-Akhdari mentions in his Sulam al-Munawraq, where he says, مَحْتَمَلَ الصِّدْقَ لِذَاتِهِ جَرَى لَدَيْهِمُ قَضِيَّةً وَخَابَرًا. He says, مَحْتَمَلَ الصِّدْقَ لِذَاتِهِ جَرَى لَدَيْهِمُ قَضِيَّةً وَخَابَرًا. Now, pay attention to this, as this is a side point and it's very important. If you look at this line of poetry which I just read right now, he says, مَحْتَمَلَ الصِّدْقَ لِذَاتِهِ جَرَى لَدَيْهِمُ قَضِيَّةً وَخَابَرًا. In his line of poetry, Al-Akhdari specifically chose not to use the word lying. So what did we just say right now? It's anything that accepts being a lie, and it can also be the truth, right? That's what we said khabar means. He didn't want to use the word lie. So he just wanted to say it's anything that accepts the truth. The reason why he's doing that is because the Qur'an has khabar in it. And look, we don't want to say that the Qur'an can accept kadhib, lie. So he's trying to get out of that. Are you with me, brothers? In the Shurrah of the Sulam, Al-Munawraq, they say taraka al-kadhiba ta'adduban. He left it out of mannerism. As Allah's speech is there. Are you with me? Others have come and said, no, 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 we can get out of that. So they came and brought something external into the definition. They brought atu min al-khariji wa adkhaluhu fil hadith. They brought something external and they entered it into the definition, which is what? ما يقبل الصدق أو الكذب لذاته. The word لذاته is what saves them according to their belief, which is that what they say is that it is anything that accepts being truth or being a lie in and within itself. In and within itself means if the speech has come from Allah, إذا لا يحمل الكذب لا يحتمل لا يقبل الكذب. Because Allah's speech in and within itself can accept a lie. No, he can't. So that's why they use the word لذاته. Are you with me, brothers? There's a great scholar, and these, by the way, brothers, one thing you need to realize, and inshallah I'm going to expand on this inshallah bi'idhnillahi al-kareem in the series that I'm going to be making called The Preservation of the Quran. I'm going to be speaking about it in details there, which is all the funoon, every field in the religion that you look at, there are scholars who are referred to as the muhaqqiquna. They're the people who are scholars who can actually reach a final conclusion regarding a particular matter and say this is what's right, everything else is wrong. If you look at qira'at, for example, and the different qira'at of the Qur'an, and what of it, which of it is authentic and can be accepted, not just because a person can read different qira'at, is he a muhaqqiq? No, not at all. Darajatu tahqiq, to be able to say that this qira'at is da'if, la yuqbal, it is not accepted, and it is not implemented, this is like a'imma, which are, these are a'imma which are known as the muhaqqiqun. And inshallah, I'm going to expand on this concept of tahqiq, at its place, bi'idhnillah. Every funoon, they are like that. If it comes to usulul fiqh, they are muhaqqiqoon of that field, who are actually known as, they don't just do taqrirul masail, where they just mention the masail and they put down the masail, the matters at hand, and they are actually, they accept, they reject, they accept, they reject. And when they bring out their point, they brought it out when they looked into the issue in very well details. And they يحققون القول, and this is قول الراجع. From those أئمة المحققون, when they looked at this definition, they didn't like it, so they rejected this definition. From them is Ibn الشاط رحمه الله in his كتاب تهذيب الفروق. Ibn الشاط رحمه الله in his كتاب تهذيب الفروق رحمه الله. He brought a very powerful way of looking at it, and it, you know why? Because his definition is very comprehensive. And it actually overcomes this particular problem that the Usuliyin are trying to complain about, or more like the Mantiqiyin are complaining about, which is, he says something even better. Because when you bring the word لذاته, you're bringing an external force to help you in your definition, which you don't need to. You don't really need to that. You don't really need to do that. So he went out and said that khabar is huwa ma yalzamuhu as-sidq aw al-kadhib. It is anything which is necessitated in it. What necessitates either has to be truth or a lie. One of the two is necessary. Isn't that better? He said, khabar is ma huwa ma yalzamu. Don't say ma yaqbalu. Get rid of yaqbalu. He says, ma yalzamuhu as-sidqa. It being the truth, aw al-kadhiba. This aw here, it's not atf. It is lit tanwi'. Okay, pay attention to it. Aw al-kadhiba means, or it's a lie. So one of the two has to necessarily be the case. Are you with me, brothers? So which of the two is necessary for Allah? That is a powerful difference. And he said the insha is what? مَا لَا يَلْزَمُ الصِّدْقَ وَالْكَذِبِ. It is anything that is not necessary to either be a lie or truth. So here, can we say that we got out of this? We got out of the problem that they were facing? نعم, we got out of the problem that they were facing. And الْبَسْطُ فِي هَذِي الْمَسْأَلَةِ, if you want to go more into these details, into this issue, Ibn al-Qayyim رحمه الله in his بَدَاءِ الْفَوَائِدِ, Ibn al-Qayyim in his kitab al-Bada'i al-Fawaid, and also as I mentioned Ibn al-Shat rahimahullah in his kitab Tahdhib al-Furuq and others, they go in more details, you could find it there. Now we're going to go to the third type of categorization of speech, right? We've already categorized it into two. The first one was what? تقسيم الكلام باعتبار ما يترتب منه. The second one was what? تقسيم الكلام باعتبار مدلوله. The third type of categorization that the author came with is تقسيم الكلام باعتبار استعماله, categorizing the speech in terms of its usage. In terms of its what? In terms of its usage. And this is where he categorized it in what? He says, وَمِنْ وَجْهٍ آخَرَ يَنْقَسِمُ إِلَىٰ حَقِيقَةٍ وَمَجَازٍ. And now he categorized the speech in terms of its usage to what? إِلَىٰ حَقِيقَةٍ and what? Majaz. Then the author, rahimahullah, what he did was that after that, he actually defined haqiqah with two definitions. Look what he said. He gave two definitions to the meaning of haqiqah. So the first one he said is what? فَالْحَقِيقَةُ مَا بَقِيَ فِي الْإِسْتِعْمَالِ عَلَى مَوْضُوعِهِ. And then the second one is وَقِيلَ. It's also said مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ. So the first one means what? That the word حَقِيقَ means. حَقِيقَ means, based on the definition he gave, is he says أَنَّ الْحَقِيقَةَ مَا بَقِيَ فِي الْإِسْتِعْمَالِ عَلَى مَوْضُوعِهِ. It is the speech that remains in how it was placed. It's not removed from how it was placed. Okay? The second definition which he said, وَقِيلَ, it is also defined as مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ. The second definition he gave is بَيَانٌ لِلْأَوَّلِ. It is بَيَانٌ لِلْأَوَّلِ. It is an explanation for the first one. It actually explains it even more. So it's not really you can't really call it two different definitions in and within itself. He's actually explained the first definition properly, which is what? مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ. It is that it is whatever is used in the manner which was agreed upon. So me and you both agree that this is a pen. Are you there, brothers? We agree. The word istilah in the Arabic language, you all have to know. Istilah actually means ما وافق عليه طائفة من القوم. It is whatever a group of people agree upon. So we all agree right now that what we're going to be calling this is what? A pen. No one can come from amongst us and call this a mobile phone, for example. The reason why he can't is because istalahna, we all agreed amongst ourselves that this is what we're going to use. So pay attention now. Brothers, are you with me? This is very important. If you take, this is called a pen. Okay? That's one example. Then we also agreed that the one that has the mane, are you there, brothers? Has claws. It's the king of the jungle. We all agreed upon it being what? A lion. That's the istilah that we all agreed upon. اصطلح عليه من المخاطبة. Are you with me, brothers? We used lion in its definition we agreed upon. If you drive it from that definition and you give it to something we did not agree upon, it leaves it being haqiqa anymore. It's not called haqiqa. Does that make sense? If you use lion for a courageous individual, a brave person, you've now used this word في غير ما استعمل عليه من المخاطبة. That you used it for other than that which you and I both agreed upon. And this is the point that he's going to speak about, which is called al-majaz. That's what majaz is. The asal of the speech is what? Pay attention. So brothers, pay attention. This is very important. Which of the two was the asal? The asal is that the lion is the lion, right? In the jungle, the king of the jungle. If somebody disputes and says, Ya akhi, you can't use lion for a courageous person, hypothetically, let's just say that. And the other person says, no, you can. Who is right? Pay attention to this question. If you, and so somebody comes and says, I'm going to use lion for a courageous person. And that's what it is right now. If I ever see a courageous person, a very brave person, I'm going to use the word lion for them. Another person comes and says, no. You are not allowed to use the word lion for a courageous person. Are you with me, brothers? You can only use it for a haywan muftaris. That animal which you see with the claws that kills and the king of the jungle, right? You can only use it for him. This dispute, if it arises, who is right? The one who is upon the asal is right by default, which is that what was agreed upon by all is that the word lion is used for this animal. You've now tried to take it away from the original usage that it used to have, and you're now going to give it a different usage. No problem. But give us a qarina, something that shows why we should accept that from you. And so he comes and he says, they both share something. And what is it that they share? They both share courage. And this person, as much as a lion is the king of the jungle, this person is the king of the city, for example. لِوَجْهِ التَّشَابُهِ بَيْنَهُمَا. There's something they have in common, so I choose to give it to them. Are you with me, brothers? Pay attention. So this, inshallah ta'ala, is a mabhath and a discussion, which we're going to be speaking about it later in more details. So this is the definition that the Shaykh rahimahullah used. But the author, rahimahullah, the definition which he gave, rahimahullah, the definition that he gave, which is al-haqiqah ma baqiya fi al-istimali ala mawdu'ihi, and the second which he gave, which is mastu'mila fi mastuliha alayhi min al-mukhataba, it basically is not encompassing the three types of haqiqah that he's going to mention, which is what? Al-haqiqah al-lughawiyya wal-urfiyya wal-shar'iyya. Are you with me, brothers? The second one is better in that manner. The first one isn't. Are you with me, brothers? So the second type of definition, which is مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ, the second definition which he mentions is actually more better in terms of its what? It's that it is more vast and it encompasses استعمال اللغوي والعرفي and الشرعي, which is حقيقة اللغوي and حقيقة العرفي and حقيقة الشرعي, which the author mentions. So the definition that we should choose is that it means مَسْتُعْمِلَ فِي مَسْطُلِحَ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ لِسَانِ الْمُخَاطَبَةِ, right? That's the definition that we chose. The second one is what we chose.